1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 32. This is a familiar text. We all have heard it before, but there's a phrase in this text that I'm going to focus on. And this phrase, I wrote about 30% of a sermon about a year ago. And it's been sitting on my computer, and I've been trying to find out when I could preach it, because the 30% I got, I really like. But I couldn't figure the rest out. I just kept just falling short, because I wanted there to be a newness about it with this old story. And so yesterday I started working on some different things, and this message hit me, and I feel like I've pulled it together in a way that will speak to you in a new way. So let's look at 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 32. David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart fail because of him." Speaking of Goliath, "Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth." And David said to Saul, "Thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took the lamb out of the flock. And I went after him, I smote him and delivered that lamb out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard and I smote him and I slew him." How many of y'all love David? Just good Lord, love it. "Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God." David said, "Moreover, the Lord hath delivered me out of the paw of the lion, out of the paw of the bear, and he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord will be with you." And Saul armed David with his armor, and he put a helmet of brass upon his head, and he armed him with a coat of mail. And David girded his sword upon his armor, and he essayed to go, for he had not proved it. He hesitated to go because he had not proved it. And David said to Saul, "I cannot go with these," speaking of Saul's armor, "for I have not proved them." I want you to underline that phrase, "I have not proved them." That's what I want to talk to you about, the proven hand of God. So David put them off. He took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones out of the brook, put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. This is a familiar story for most of us that are here, but to give you some quick background, there is that phrase, "I have not proved them." I've never really focused on that phrase before, but it's been speaking so loudly to me. We would know that the Philistines had been a historical enemy of Israel's for many, many years. And so Saul calls Israel to take up arms against the Philistines in the Valley of Elah. Goliath shows up as the captain of the Philistines, 10-foot tall. He's impressive. He's armed with the greatest military equipment of that day. His armor, his shield, and his sword, all intimidating and impressive. And Goliath suggests that Israel choose a captain as well to bring their fiercest warrior to the field, and they'll battle together, and whoever wins goes the spoils. And that the nation that loses will be the servant of the nation that wins. David's taken a care package to his brothers, and as he's doing this, he hears Goliath threatening the armies of Israel, and he says to his brothers, "Why doesn't somebody go take this man out? Why are we just sitting back, allowing this guy to threaten and intimidate us? Why doesn't someone go knock his block off?" So David goes to King Saul, and King Saul immediately dismisses the idea that David could go fight Goliath because of his age, because he's not experienced, because when you look at the natural, David did not have what Saul had. And David's response to the king was, "I want you to see these hands. These hands killed a bear. These hands killed the lion. These hands have done the unimaginable." So Saul looks at David, and he looks at Goliath. He looks at David's hands, and he looks at Saul's armor. And immediately Saul, out of compassion, is saying, okay, if David's going to go, he's going to need my help. And so Saul gives him the king's armor. This is an impressive piece of armor. This is the best armor of that day. And Saul knows that David is going to need his help. Any practical person would agree with what Saul is doing. Saul's armor increases David's odds and chances at success. It's the armor of a king. This is the best possible advantage David could be given. David says there's a problem with this armor. When I killed the bear, I didn't have this armor. When I killed the lion, I didn't have this armor. All I had was these hands. Don't look like much, but that's what I had. I had these hands, I had a slingshot, I had some stones. I don't know about the armor, but I know about these hands. It's interesting to me that he says to the king, I'll go, but I can't go with these, speaking of the armor, for I have not proved them. The problem with the American church is we keep talking about all these new ways of doing things. I'm not speaking about style. You can scripturally see that God's not interested in style. What he is interested in, what he is concerned about, are the timeless proven principles and truths of Scripture. And it's interesting that God's people have a tendency to try to negotiate the timeless truths that are evident in Scripture and throughout church history. I was talking to Tom Cocaine, a member of our church, this week, and he said there's two things we know about history. First thing that we know is that history repeats itself. The second thing we know is we don't learn from history. Isn't that good? So this is not a new thing. This is a continued issue that God's people have always had. You see it in the early church. You see it in all of Paul's writings. Anytime he would establish a church, people would come in and they would start to debate and negotiate and try to tear down the timeless truths of God's people that have always held them established in whatever situations the world is going through. I believe that the American church has an issue because we think that God is American. Right, that God's into democracy. I love America, I believe in democracy. It's the greatest system that the world has ever known. Without any question, I thank God for our freedoms. But God is not about democracy. God is a theocracy. He is the king of his kingdom. He does not debate whether or not his kingdom will rule. So he establishes the rules of his kingdom, the principles of his kingdom, and we don't get a vote on it. I'll say that one more time. We don't get a vote on it. Talk to me. We don't get a vote on it. He's not checking in with us on our opinions. I've got mine as well as you have yours. And a lot of my opinions, I would have no way put in the Bible. So he doesn't change his eternal law to accommodate today's trends. No matter how reasonable they are, no matter how practical or even spiritual they are, no matter how wonderful the world's armor looks, God is always here saying, I can't go with these because I have not proved them. 2 Chronicles chapter 30, verse 12, also in Judah, the hand of God was on the people to give them unity of mind to carry out what the king and his officials had ordered following the word of the Lord. It's interesting to me that the hand of God was on Judah. Why? Because they followed, they obeyed the word of the Lord. God's hand is on us. The proven hand of God is on us when or if we obey and follow his word. The issue in our lives is there's things that we've adopted, there's things that we've accepted, there's things that we're living by, and we've not proved them. God has not proved them. It takes these hands, David said, to kill the lion. It takes these hands to kill the bear. It took these hands to kill Goliath. It took these hands to go and rescue the lamb out of the mouth of every predator that I faced. And God's method has always been proven hands. And his hands are proven. Acts 7 and verse 50, was it not my hand which made all these things? Isaiah 64 and verse 8, but now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay and you are potter. And all of us are the work of your hand. Psalms 98 and verse 1, oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done wonderful things. Has God done wonderful things for anybody here? It was by his right hand. It was by his hand that those wonderful things came, and they gained him the victory. 1 Chronicles 4 and verse 10, the prayer of Jabez. Oh, that you would bless me indeed, enlarge my border, and that your hand might be with me, that you would keep me from harm, that I may not cause pain. And God granted him what he requested. He said, God, I don't want to go forward without your proven hand on my life. And the Bible says, because he asked for it, God granted him his request. Luke 1:66, all who heard them kept them in mind, saying, what then will this child turn out to be? For the hand of the Lord was certainly with him. Acts 11 and verse 12, and the hand of the Lord was with them, speaking of the early church, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. 1 Peter 5 and verse 6, this is in our court. The ball is in our court now. If you'll humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. It takes humility to say, I need his proven hand. And when you humble yourself and you say, I do not want to move forward in life without your proven hand, the Bible says, in the proper time, he'll exalt you and lift you up. I love that great song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. What does it say? All that I hath needed, thy hand hath provided. The hand of God is proven. Like David, it's with these hands. We need the hand of God on our life. We need his hands on our hands. Now, anything else that we want to go at life with, these are not proven. Now, what's interesting to me is if you go into the scripture, there are all kinds of places that God proves us. God tests us. He tries us. He puts us through various trials to prove or to purify, to see what's in our hearts. And you could Google that word if you wanted, and you're going to see a plethora of verse after verse after verse after verse where God tests us, where God proves us, where God is endeavoring to see what's on the inside of us. Then you go and you do the same type of a search in a commentary to talk about proving God. And what you'll find is it's the opposite. He says, don't prove me. Don't test me. Don't tempt me, over and over and over. Jesus is in the wilderness. Satan takes him up right in the high place. And he says, if you'll throw yourself down, then the angels will scoop you up and catch you. And what does Jesus say? You do not test the Lord your God. Paul's talking about sin and grace and the difference between sin and grace and law and grace. And the Bible says that he starts to tell people that it's not by the law that you and I are made right before God. There's no way that the law could have accomplished it. That was the schoolmaster. That was the teacher. That was like the thing that was going to introduce us to the sure thing, the real thing in Jesus. And so then Paul says this. He says, so does that mean we should have a license to sin, that we should just keep on sinning because God's grace is what makes us right before God? And Paul says, certainly not. In other words, we're not supposed to see how much we can sin and still get to heaven. We're not to see how much stuff we can get in our life because God loves us and he's given us his grace. We're not to test his grace. It's abundant. It's available. It's great. There's no one that it can't reach and can't help and can't rescue it. But yet we're not to prove that. We could continue to go through the places where God says, don't test me. Don't prove me. So the question then remains to me is, then how can I know that his hand is proven? How could I know? How might I know that the hand of God is proven? Well, there's just one place that God does allow. He gives this moment where he says, this is the only place I want you to prove me. The problem with this area is it's not Saul's armor. It's not impressive. It's not amazing. It's not fun. No one's gonna get warm fuzzies because we talk about it, right? There's gonna be no goosebumps. There's gonna be none of that because that's what Saul's armor does. That's what the world's way of going at things look like. But this is going to be the place where we begin to see it's these hands that kill the lion. It's these hands that kill the bear. It's these hands. Let's look at it together, Malachi 3 and verse 10. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be meat in mine house. Here it is. And prove me now. Everybody say now. Now. There's a reason God put that word in there. I would circle it. Saith the Lord. The Goliaths of our world hate this verse because it says he will open up the windows of heaven and open out and pour out a blessing that you have not room enough to receive it. Now, there are opinions around this subject. I'm aware of them. I've done this my whole life. But these are not proven. And I'll show you over the next few minutes that there are some ways that the world does things. And when we look at the world, when we look at the Goliath, and we look at the size, and we look at the scope, and we look at the impressive way that the world goes at things, it's tempting for us to start trying to put on the way that the world does certain things. And it takes a great level of humility to look at Saul's armor, to look at the world's armor, and say, these hands is how I killed the lion. These hands is how I killed the bear. The word prove in the Greek and Hebrew, if you study the etymology of the word, give us four primary definitions, and we're gonna look at them together. The first one is prove. What do you say? Prove me now. It means to render certain or to put out of doubt. Are you uncertain on the subject of tithing? God said he gets it, he understands it, so he said, prove me now. Prove means this is an absolute. It means this can be trusted. It might be that the world's armor is the best thing ever, but it's unproven. It's unproven in my life. It's unproven in the larger scope of life. If you look at every area of life, besides just the financial area of life that we need God's blessing, the way that the world does it is unproven. But the problem is we let the world tell us how to think about these things. But these hands, that's what I know. These hands are what God looks at. It's his hand on these hands. There's no substitute for that. Whatever battlefield of life you're going into, whatever struggle in life you're facing, it's these hands that kill the lion. It's these hands that kill the bear. It's these hands that take out Goliath. It renders, listen to it, certain, or it puts out of doubt. I love this. Render certain, put out of doubt. The word prove means to judge by trial. This is a tough one for me because I almost felt uncomfortable writing it down. That God said, I want you to put my character on trial. I don't know a lot about trials, but I do know there's several things that are there. You're gonna have the prosecutor, right? Then you're gonna have the advocate. God's saying, I'm the advocate for tithing. There's the prosecutor that's gonna come at this in every which way he can, and then both sides are gonna pull in their witnesses, right? So God's gonna pull in his witnesses, and that's the tithing line. This is a short line, by the way. I've been told that whenever you say something hard, you're supposed to smile. Okay. So this is a short line. And now we got this long line of non-tithers. It's a long line. But it's not proven. Beautiful portfolios. Can you see Goliath's armor? Positions, you name it, they've got it. But if you bring those witnesses forward, and then you bring those who are saying, these hands, is how I killed the lion. These hands is how I killed the bear. When you pull that line up, according to what Malachi says, you can put the character of God on trial. And what you will come up with every single time is that this line, though it's a short line, this is the group of people that when they face the lion, somehow the devourer comes at their family and they overcome. They grab that thing and they smote him every time. Somehow they defeat the bear of fear. Somehow they face every Goliath that comes along because they understand this isn't the impressive way. This is God's way of having his hands on my hands. 15 years ago, I taught for the very first time on the subject of giving. And I remember how nervous I was around that time. I don't get that nervous anymore because I actually get great joy in watching people get breakthroughs in this area. But I remember going into that service and I'd heard an old preacher talk about how he had given his church a giving challenge. Now, I had never seen this done. I'd never watched this be done. And this would have been an old preacher. Like, if you don't know me yet, you'll learn I love old preachers. The older I can find, the better. I don't know what it is. I just like them. And so I decided that I was going to do that. I was going to give the church a giving challenge. What he did was he said 1 year. That's what was his thing. He said, I told the church I'd give them 1 year, that if they prove God in this area, if they found out that God didn't, he's put on trial, if they did not render it certain, if it did not put out a doubt that his hand would be on their life, then he said, I would give it all back at the end of that year. I didn't have the confidence to do a year. So I called some friends, some different people that I look up to. I said, hey, I'm thinking about this. What do you think about it? They said, that's not a good idea. They said, it's going to get really messy if you do that. I was like, I don't know. I'm just really curious what would happen. And so we gave the church a giving challenge, 12 weeks where they could begin. And we would track with them. We would be there with them. We'd check in with them, send them an email, send them some resources, encourage them along the way. And at the end of 12 weeks, they would receive that email as they entered it, if they communicate with us that they're doing it. And then at the end of that 12 weeks, if for some reason they didn't like it, didn't want to do it, all they had to do is send the email back, and we would give them everything they gave back, no questions asked. 15 years ago. In 15 years, we've had thousands of people take the giving challenge. But out of the thousands of people that have gone through it, and every year I've done that, and I'm doing that again today, I'm issuing the challenge, and we still haven't had one person that with a true heart, not because I'm trying to provoke you, but with a real pure heart, have come before God and said, God, I want to prove you now. Not one, because he's been on trial for 15 years, and this short little line keeps finding out that you can prove him now. It will render you certain. It will put out of doubt that his hand on your hands can do the impossible. Number two, the word prove means shown to be right with the accusative thing or person against. I love that. God's spirit is never against Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10. If you read the scriptures or you read early church history or at any point where God's spirit has been poured out in a wonderful way, there's been unusual generosity attached to it. So the only spirit on people that's against biblical generosity is not God's spirit. I understand that people struggle with this. We've had people for years attend our church, decades attend our church, and they don't give. They don't financially support the church, and they're welcome here. They'll always be welcome. They don't get a bill. They don't get pushed aside. They don't get treated differently. Everything here is provided for them the same way it is for the person that is consistent. My point is not you have to do it. You don't have to do anything. My point is the Bible says prove. Well, there's a spirit against the biblical idea of generosity, which is what's the biblical idea of generosity? He taught us here in Malachi 3 verse 10 that you give the tithe 10% to his house or to your local church, that there might be provision or meat in that house as you will need it. This is the starting point for how you prove him now. Not so he'll bless you, because he's already blessed you. You bring it back to him because he's already blessed you. You don't do it so he will, you do it because he has. And look to the cross if you wonder if he has. So Luke chapter 16, verse 13 introduces this thing or spirit that's accusative against biblical generosity. It says this, Jesus is talking, you cannot serve both God and mammon. The word mammon is mentioned four times in the Bible. It's an Aramaic term that means the God of riches. So it's not speaking of money. It's speaking about an idea called mammon, which is how people personify money and turn it into a living being or a God. You say, well, there's no such thing as money living. Well, the question would be, then why do you let it talk to you so much? Because it does talk a lot, does it not? For some of you, it's been talking so loudly throughout this service, you literally can't hear what I'm saying. You can't hear it because there's no pressure. Mammon will put a lot of pressure on you, but Jesus is not gonna put pressure on you. It's your responsibility to decide, do I want Saul's armor or do I want these hands? So he goes on to say, you can't serve both. Because what happens is the thing you think you own will actually own you. And you'll turn money into a god. And this is how the Bible says Satan controls believers. And what do they say? They say things like this. I can't believe they talk about that in church. They should never talk about that in church. Why? You're talking about their god. And mammon hates being talked about. Does not like it, does not want it, and definitely doesn't want God's people being talking about it. So Jesus warns us and he says, listen, this is how Satan will control the people of God. So we see this in Revelation chapter 13, that this is how it's going to work. That the Antichrist will show up on the planet, and the way he'll rule and reign is he'll get people to bow down to him, not through military force, not through threats or intimidation or political power, but he'll do it through financial power. He'll say, if you do not take the mark of the beast, you will not be able to buy or sell. What's the threat? If you don't bow down to me, you can't take care of your family. If you don't bow down to me, you can't have your needs met. If you don't bow down to me, you won't be able to provide the basic necessities of life. If you don't bow down to me, you won't even be able to eat. If you don't bow down to me, what's the whole idea? What's the whole point? The spirit of mammon, as we know, controls the world. That's not the question. For anybody that's a thinking Christian, you know the spirit of mammon controls the world. The question is, will we allow it to control us? Are we going to allow it to control God's people? And that's what Jesus is saying. And this is the reality behind it. I've met very few people possessed by demons, but I've met a lot of people possessed by possessions. And Jesus is saying, hey, let's be careful when it comes to the spirit of mammon. And so prove. It means that there's an accusative thing, person, spirit, mindset against it. And God said, the tithe is how I silence that spirit and that mindset. Number three, prove means there's no in between. So there's no gray areas on this subject. The truth will be found, and there's two extremes. So when you put God on trial or you put this subject on trial, it'll be found either it's true or it's a lie. No gray. It'll be found right or wrong, black or white, hero or coward, light, darkness. There's no in between. So when you bring the tithe, God says, it's proven. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you that I'm good. I'm gonna show you that you can't outgive me. I'm gonna show you that I'm a good God, that I wanna bless my children. And what I will show you is that your 90% in my hand is more blessed than the 100% in your hand. That's what he'll show you. I know it's a cliche, but it is absolutely proven there's no in between. How is it even possible? I love how the question is asked. is God a man that he should lie? And the response is, let God be true and let every man be a liar. There's no in between. You will find his word is true every time. You can prove him in this. You can prove him in this. Number four, prove means a proof of genuineness. It means to establish validity and authenticity. Think about David. Look at Saul's beautiful armor. Look at the threat of Goliath. Nothing about David bringing up his hands looks sufficient. Saul looks at David's hands and he says, there's no way that will ever work against that Goliath. There's no way those hands are enough to defeat what you're facing. It is impossible. And out of compassion, Saul says, I want to help David out. And David is authentic. He knows it's always been the proven hand of God on his life. He knows it was these hands that killed the lion. It was these hands, these ones, not Saul's armor, not some man-made way, not some worldly way. It was the proven hand of God on his hand. And I just want to say the reason God does it this way is because he wants to show the world that it's him behind his people, and God will never share his glory with Saul's armor. When God gives you the victory on the battlefield, when God gives you the victory up against the impossible in life, when God shows himself to be strong and proves his mighty hand on your life, he will share that glory with no man. Let no man, no flesh glory in the mighty presence of God. It is his proven hand we need. I can say for me and for this church, it's been the proven hand of God time and time again, and he shares his glory with no man. You see, it takes courage to walk away from the world system. It takes courage to walk away from Saul's armor. Why? Because there's the deception in it that that's where protection is. But that's not the proven for God's kids. That's not proven. And you have to say, I cannot go with these things, for they are not proven. But these hands. And that's what you do. That's really what David did. He said, I'm going to give God these hands again. And that's really the idea is, God, we're going to give you our hands. We're going to give you our hands. There's some battles that we have to face that are bigger than us. And the world's way is just not going to work. So I give you these hands. And let your hands be on my hands. And so many of you are here, you're saying, I want to take that giving challenge, or you should take that giving challenge. You should pray about it at least. And you say, well, how would I do that? Well, I think we fall into a few different categories. One is those who are just sporadic, just have been inconsistent in this area of their life. It's not that you're not having a desire to be generous, but you're just inconsistent. And I think that it would be a good thing for you to say, I'm going to be consistent. I'm going to stay faithful. I'm going to put God first in this area of my life. For others of you, you were faithful and you just pulled back, sometimes for no reason. Got busy, things got crazy, you got out of the discipline of it, and maybe at this point in your life, you're just here saying, you know what, Pastor, I get it. I know what you're saying. I know that it's these hands. I know his hand is proven, but I just need to begin again, and maybe that's for you. Maybe you're here today and you've never proven. Well, I love the fact that it says, prove now. Prove now. Just go ahead and do it now. In other words, God knew. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. Don't wait a day, a week, a month. Don't do that, because mammon's going to talk you out of it. So in the presence of God, in the house of God, when faith is at its greatest, that's when we hear God's word, when faith is at its strongest, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word, make a decision to say, I'm going to prove him now, to render certain, to put out a doubt whether or not God's proven hand will come through for you in your situation. Amen.